Check. Good morning, everybody. After the first talk, this is the second talk about Relax and Recover. And Johannes, my colleague of the project, will give a live demo. We will switch perhaps first, because he needs some time to start the demo. Yeah, you can switch. I will let Johannes explain what he will do. Not too close to your mouth, so otherwise you will not like this.
Okay. On this laptop, I have installed...
We don't see anything yet.
We don't see anything. What's wrong? It has worked.
Maybe you can explain.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Now you see what's happening on my laptop. I have the Relax and Recover software installed. And now I let it do a backup of the data plus some more things. I create an image or a bootable image that I can later use to reinstall the laptop. And this takes some time. This is why we start it right now. You don't see much. It's just doing its job. So, 1 minute. So I start it. And I start here the clock. And now I hand over to Gratien, who will explain what RIA is, how it works, while this just runs. But it's a live demo. This backup that is right now made will be later used to recreate the laptop, and I will destroy it. I will not physically destroy it because I only have one. But I make the system completely.
Johannes, where is the destination of your backup?
Yes, the destination of the backup is something that you can use. It's a USB drive. The faster the drive is, the faster is your backup. So I used a spinning disk. It works better than a USB stick, a cheap one. If you have a high-end USB stick, it's also okay, but I preferred this spinning disk. It's reliable.
Okay. We will switch now the display. Okay. All right. Johannes already explained that he started his rear backup on the USB device. This is a more thinking slide for why is the need of Relax and Recover to have a disaster recovery image of your Linux system. Whatever. You all here, you probably understand why you need it, so let's skip that. Let's go directly to Relax and Recover. It is a disaster recovery solution. It works online. That is very important, so you don't have to take an offline backup. The systems can stay offline, online, I mean. It is completely written in Bash. We have chosen, RIA was designed in 2006, it's quite some time ago already. And before RIA, there was a Make CD-ROM Recovery project also written in Bash, so that's just extended it. The nice thing about RIA is it is completely modular written. So it means each Bash script can be very, very tiny, can be bigger, but you can just make everything very modular and you can test it very easily like that. It is working on a lot of architectures now, even on Z-Linux, on the IBM. So IBM is a big sponsor now for making RIA working fine on their mainframe-like systems, LPAR systems, and so on and so on. So everything with x86 is supported, of course. PPC is supported, and some other architectures. Okay, I already said it's online. And it integrates, of course, with backup solutions, external backup solutions, and internal backup solutions. I come back to that. All right. RIA is, it takes started in 2006. I think in 2009 it got a broader knowledge about the in the communities. Big customers will start using it. It is open source, so they don't have to pay for it, of course, but they use it. I think SUSE was one of the first that really ships Relax and Recover with their high availability solution. And after that, Fedora and RHEL came. I think in most operating systems, it is now part of the mainstream executables or packages, I have to say. The nice thing about RHEL is that the integration is very well working with external backup solutions, so that RHEL is very concentrating itself on the disaster recovery only. And the backup is, in fact, something else. So the purpose is of RHEL is to recover as fast as possible your basic operating system. And the rest can be recovered through external backup if needed. Or you have, or you can choose to do it directly with external backup, and then you only have a very small part of a bootable image that only recovers your basic drives and file systems mounted, and then the recovery starts through the external backup interfaces. And it scales very well. In the next talk, I will talk about scaling. So that's also interesting. Already explained, use RHEL and or use the best tool for your job, in fact. You can do RHEL recovery, and you can recover everything from A to Z, in fact, from your system. But you can also do only the basic OS recovery, and then use something else to recover your data, to recover your configuration by means of configuration management, software management, etc., etc. So RHEL is, in fact, the best tool for a job, and it is really meant to be excellent on the system devices, operating system level. All the rest can be done or can be added, but it's not necessarily needed. If you're fine with, for example, Puppet or Ceph to do your configuration management or restore everything afterwards, on system level, you can do it. You can just integrate it. Okay, let's explain the backup and the output flow, because that's important to understand. There are two flows. It speaks for itself. Backup is meant to send your backup of your operating system to a means. You have an internal one. The internal one that we define as using tar or rsync. Okay, everything which is external can be another program to do backup. For example, Barrios. We have done several Barrios examples in other presentations as an external backup solution. It works perfectly fine. But there are so many. I think almost all backup solutions are supported. I can only think about one or two that's not yet inside RHEL. But for all the rest of backup solutions are already integrated. That's the backup. The output is, in fact, your disaster image, the image that you create to boot from afterwards. And the image can be an ISO image, can be on a USB stick, can be network booting. So these are the possibilities. So you have to decide, if you want to make a disaster recovery schema, you have to decide, where do I want to put my backup? Do I want to boot from ISO? Do I want to boot from USB or network? Where will reside the backups? Is it on a NAS environment? Is it on the cloud? Because it's also integration in the cloud is possible, or it's already in RHEL itself. So there are a lot of possibilities. So you have to decide, and once you made the decision, you can start configuring RHEL in the configuration files. So the basics of RHEL is, of course, there's a main script. It's a bash script. Everything in RHEL is bash. So also the configuration files. So it's also a bash script. Well, it's variables, but if something missing, a code is missing, you will get an error in RHEL. So remember that. So the main commands are make rescue or make backup. What's the difference? Make rescue will also only make the disaster recovery image, and no backup will be made. The make backup includes the rescue image and the backup. If you're using an external backup, for example, then normally make backup is the same as make rescue. because you rely on the external backup interfaces to make your full backup of your system. So you don't need Rear to take an extra backup. Although it is a possibility to force it. For example, Barrios made a very tiny script that forces a backup. That's a possibility. Everything is possible within Rear. Another important part is the recover part. Of course, recovery you only do when you boot off your rescue image. And then you can do a recover. Rear is clever enough that you can't do a recover on your live OS, right? Documentation is available, and there's a very good man page, and the website is also there to explain the things which are not clear. And there are also user mailing lists and stuff like that. So, and there's also GitHub with issues, lots of them. And, well, you can find a lot of information on the internet. So the methods, explained the backup already, which are some possibilities. Duplicity is a cloud backup solution, for example. And the backup URL is, in fact, defining the location of your backup. So you say backup, for example, equals netfs. That means that you will use the internal network, more or less. What we call netfs is more NFS-like. Okay. But a location has to be added, and that you do in backup URL. The same is true for output. Output is then ISO, PIXI, OBDR. Is somebody still using bootable tape drives? I don't think so. So. And USB. And same output URL. If you don't define an output URL, it will be the same as the backup URL. That's important to know. But all right. This is an overview of the possibilities. If you say output is PIXI and backup is NetFS, then it means that you will be booting from a network somewhere, that you need a PIXI environment to boot from. Rear can set it up for you. That is not a possibility that is there. USB is bootable, makes a bootable USB drive. ISO image is booting from an image or a physical ISO. Or DVD is also a possibility. You can make a bootable ISO image, including the backup, and you can put it on a bootable DVD. And there is a few big scanner companies in the world. There are only two of them, and they're all using Linux for their scanning software, and they all have a DVD delivered and that is made with Rear to do the recovery of their scanning machine. They don't know it, but I know it, okay. Okay, some examples of the locations of the URLs. So it's quite easy, I would say. File, NFS, SIFS, Samba, USB, ISO, and even tape. NetFS, this is an example that you can add in the local configuration file. Backup program is the default internal backup solution, but you can replace it with rsync if rsync is used internally, because you also have rsync that you can point to somewhere, even to the cloud, by way of speaking, but then it's not an internal backup anymore. And there are some options. You can find all the options that are described here in the default configuration file. If you just find it, default.conf, and you find everything in there. Everything which is possible within the Rear is described in there. What is coming now is just example configuration files. The presentation is already online on the FOSDEM website. I will also publish it on our website. But okay, these are possibilities. There's so many things that are already shipped with Rear. You can find it in the default configuration subdirectories in the examples. I think there are a lot of examples in there which are useful as a start. If you are not sure what to do, you can just have a look at it and then you have a clue, in fact. Another thing that within Rear, you can also type Rear dump. And then it will show you which configuration files will be read. And it is in this order. That means the last local.conf file is the last configuration file that will be read. So everything which is added there will overrule everything else which is over there. That's important to know. Local.conf is the last one. Here are examples. This is a very simple example. Copy as is. You can just add your own executables to the disaster recovery image. Result files, you can anything to there, which is also left there. Output ISO is the standard, or the default, I would say. Not the standard, it's a default. But most of the time, so it's the most used. An interesting thing is here, the only include volume group. If you have a system disk, we will switch then. We will switch because the rest is only configuration examples. You can exclude stuff from your backup that you don't want. And you can add evil users, because that's for a customer that I do that. If they want to recover Oracle immediately and after disaster recovery, then it's there. And we do it automatically. SAP, we do exercises with SAP also. So you want to exclude the data files because you recover from external backup, etc., etc. Okay, I will switch back to Johannes.
The microphone. Just a moment. Don't put it here, not too close. Okay. So now I made the backup. It took about 12 minutes. So, and the backup is now on the USB drive, and there is also the USB drive is prepared to boot the recovery system. Both things are now on the USB drive. Now I destroy this system as good as possible. With software, only one example, because it's fast, I remove all libraries. Just so. Now nothing works. Simple commands like list something doesn't work. Okay, let's do a reboot, because perhaps it helps. Also not possible. So yes, messed up. So I need to reboot the hard way, the very hard way. So now it's off. Now I boot the system that is on the USB drive. Escape, F9. This is HDMI cable. I don't know what is going on. It has worked. I try the Windows bay redo things. So I don't know. So it will not be on the video, but for you, you can see I boot from the USB drive, USB hard drive. Enter. Now something. I do not understand what's wrong. And now I have a boot menu from the recovery system on the USB drive, and I choose the topmost image, this one, and again, let's hope. I think when the kernel starts, then things get better. Now it loads the kernel from the from the USB drive and the initial RAM disk. I would show. Let's wait. Now the kernel boots and nothing else. One cannot see it. Oh, okay. So for those on the video, I booted from the USB drive. Nothing was seen. There was no output on the HDMI cable, so there's nothing on the video. But what is now booted is the relax and recover rescue system or recovery system. I log in there as root and type the recovery command. There's one question: if the disk layout is the same, it's to avoid that you get interesting effects if you install the new system on the USB drive. So this there are now two disks, the USB disk and the system disk. So in certain cases, it can happen that the installation happens on the wrong disk. So there is a check that this does not so often happen. It's clear you have two drives. I have 10 minutes left. That's good because the backup took about 15 minutes, 12 minutes. But this is usually much faster. And now we have to wait to restore the backup. What it does, you see, it does a complete system setup. It does partitioning, creates partitions, and all these things. And at the end, the backup is restored. And then I can reboot the system. There are other possibilities. In this case, I would not need to do the partitioning again and to reinstall the bootloader. I only messed up some files. And I have it prepared on the system, but I cannot show it because I have no time here. You can boot the recovery system as an other entry of the regular grub that is on the hard disk. So you do not need to boot from the USB drive. You boot the recovery system from your normal drive. And then you can restore the backup also from your normal drive if you have it on a separate partition on your normal drive. So this could help for software errors. And I show here the complete recreation of the system which you need if your hard drive gets broken, if it's physically broken. And what also should work, that you connect this USB drive to another laptop that is sufficiently similar and install it from there, from the USB drive. So, at the end, it's also not needed in this case, re-migrate some configuration files. For example, if you have different network, you have to do some little adjustments. But it's not a complete reconfiguration of the system. It's only the very minimum that is needed to boot to get the recreated system up and running. So if you do a complicated migration, you have to do something more. You cannot just let redo everything. But you can, of course, it's bash scripting. You can extend and enhance it as you need it. And I think this is the main reason why it's so much used on server systems and so. I think the admins like it that if something needs to be done, they just hack it in. They need to learn a complicated system. Just look what the bash scripts do. Oh, this looks like the right place, hack it in. Perhaps it's not exactly the right place, but you get your thing done in a relatively short time. Now it installs the bootloader, which is also not needed in this case, but in general, it's done. And I could speed things up. I let Rear automatically determine where to install the bootloader. This takes a little bit of time. And if I specify install the bootloader on dev SDA, then things get a little bit faster. You can set up so many things, so many possibilities to fine tuning as you need. But the more you configure, the less it works in the general case if you have to do it on a different laptop. But that's also not a big problem, because in the recovery system, you can adjust what you like. You have a complete Linux system, only this command line, no graphical interface. But theoretically, you can reboot, just a moment, reboot. So I unplug the USB drive when the system is off to show you that there's only the hard drive. Oh, there's again nothing on the video, but now it boots again. It's my standard system. It's the one that I destroyed. I swear it's the one that it's no trick. Yes, it took 6 minutes, something like this, 10 minutes. And I have here not a test system, a small one. It's a regular, normal system with GNOME desktop and LibreOffice and all the things. But of course, if I had 2 terabytes of videos, I would not back up them with RIA. Because if you need to go to be back soon, and the restore of the backup takes hours, it doesn't help. Usually you don't need your videos. So this is also something that Gratian explained. You can do the backups in parts. Your basic system and your essential files that you really need and your optional files. So it's flexible. Bottom line, RIA is flexible. Yes, I'm back again. Perhaps I should even start something. So a browser, doesn't matter, it works. Stop. Yeah. Only to show it's the same that system that was completely messed up. Now it's working 7 minutes later. Perhaps it helps you if you, perhaps not this time, next FOSDEM. You have RIA with a USB device, so if you mess up something, you just show something to someone, and oh shit, everything messed up. No problem, your talk 1 hour later is safe, you reinstall your system, and nobody noticed that you did something bad. Okay, that's all from me. I think the next thing is question and answers, and I would give back the microphone to Gratien, if he wants.
You can answer.
I should answer.
Yeah.
So we do it both. Questions?
If your laptop uses full disk encryption, will the recovery reset up?
Yes, we have support for what it is called?
Lux.
Lux, yes, of course. Yes. And if you have Megalux, something else, then it's shell scripting, and it's not so complicated to add it. Oh, I forgot. I must repeat the question. The question was if encrypted disks are supported. Yes, they are supported when they use Lux as encryption mechanism.
At the end of the restore, there was some line, please type rmrf temp RIA something. What is stored in the temp folder, or why do I need to delete it?
The question was, at the end, was some line, one should remove a TMP RIA something. I have a special setting that's not the default. In the temp folder, RIA builds its recovery system and does its temporary stuff.
Okay.
And usually it gets deleted by default, but because I mainly develop RIA, I usually keep it because then I can look what they're in. So that's not the default, and of course, as everything, you can, there's a configuration variable, and you set it, and then things happen different.
Have you already tried to back up physical machine and restore on a virtual machine?
Migration from physical to virtual is possible, but as always, when you migrate and things change too much, then you have to do something. For example, you have a physical machine with 2 hard drives and a virtual machine with 1. Then the hard drive's configuration cannot be applied directly on the virtual machine.
Maybe one important thing to mention. No, you can keep it for a moment.
I'll keep it.
If you want to do physical to virtual, there is something as a disk layout. So the RIA also creates a disk layout configuration. You can edit that file and map it to the destination effect if you have one disk less or something like that. Yeah. It's us. We do that. For example, I think it was not Amazon, but Zalando did it. Yeah, one of the project leaders from the beginning. You worked a long time for Zalando. You used a lot of times Rio to do physical to virtual. You're welcome.